Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel. And I've got a new little place to sit. I'm feeling very like Meghan Markle in Suits, like a bit. Anyway, and I thought I would take this opportunity to address the whole concept of law tech or legal technology. And this is very relevant for people who are going to go for a job interview, because all law firms are talking about it, and if they're not explicitly talking about it, they're doing it behind closed doors in some way or another. A Law Society Gazette interview with Jeff Moore, who is the managing partner of Arthur Cox, and he said that no robot will ever replace a lawyer. And and that the judgment and the kind of trusted business advisor, which has, you know, every single lawyer now is a trusted business advisor, that's never going to be done away with. But in my humble opinion, and from all of the research I've done, and granted I'm not a partner in a law firm, so I haven't been there a long time, but you have to admit that the trend is gearing towards remote working, and technology is playing a much, much greater role in law. Like, even during this COVID thing, we can see, for example, that there are hearings in the Irish higher courts that are being heard virtually. All of the major players, like the property registration authority, the company's registration office, they've all been forced online. And it's my belief that this will trigger all of those projects that had been in the pipeline, like, for example, e-conveyancing, that those things will become automated, and people will move into robotics maintenance rather than, we'll say, due diligence or administrative tasks that humans have traditionally done. So I recently did the diploma in IP and IT law in the Law Society, and we had a specific module on law tech that was presented by Le Mans Solicitor, and they are actually a paperless office. They have an ISO standard for the way they do business, and they also allow their clients real-time access to their files, which from my point of view is the right thing to do. I think that delay and blaming things on couriers and the post and all of that is just hiding behind inefficiencies. And I know that's a very strong, stark thing to come out and say, but that's just my experience. I think people hide behind administration for laziness, and it doesn't serve the client, it racks up fees. And yeah, that's the other thing we have to recognize here, is that there is inertia. And that means that there are certain stakeholders that don't want to see legal tech take off, quite understandably, because robotics and automation do away with jobs, like they do in any industry. Like, when the horse was done away with and cars were brought in, there's lots of people lost their jobs, but those people just transitioned into driving cars, and that was the Industrial Revolution. There will be a tech revolution, and it's already starting. It's not highfalutin, like iRobot style, the robots are going to come and kill us all. It's just that we have to be aware that our jobs are not safe long term. They aren't. Certainly, if you're a solicitor starting off at the moment, you can be sure that in the next 10 to 20 years, your role is going to change massively. And the people who are sitting in the positions they've been in for 20 to 40 years, they've made their money, they've billed every billable hour possible, but that model is no longer going to function when you have very young, innovative, cost-driven, demanding tech clients who just won't pay the bill, and they will go tooth and nail through the bill and ask, okay, how come it took you 5 hours to do this research? We could have one of our people or a robot do that in 20 seconds. Why am I going to pay €1,500 just for your two-line answer? And I think that's pretty reasonable, to be honest. I know I am part of the problem, but I'm also an aware observer of how you may have heard of Richard Susskind, and he has been, so he's like ex Allen and Overy, and then he became a business consultant because he just saw the need for his type of awareness in the legal industry and to, you know, embrace economies of scale, make kind of law firms who are have pretty insular ways of thinking, very hierarchical, very set in their ways. He's normally brought in to shake things up, and being an ex-lawyer himself, he's perfect. I'd all recommend you read his book. I read it a few Christmases ago. My mom got it for me for Christmas. And yeah, that's what spiraled my way of thinking, and I think it's something you all would benefit from. He's been talking about this kind of globalization, commoditization of law for years. It's not a new, he's actually been talking about it since the 90s, so it's not a new concept at all. But just briefly, I've jotted down here. So law tech consists of document automation, which is like, for example, if you want to draft a contract and like, you know, you need certain clauses, we'll say like termination, force majeure, variation, jurisdiction, choice of law. We'll say you need all of those boilerplate clauses. You could go to like Thomson Reuters Practical Law, and they have like a clause machine. Something like some Christmassy clause machine. They have like a clause machine, and you just like drop in all the clauses you want, and then you can negotiate them away with your counterparty. And I think that's amazing, because that means like you don't have to, like you don't have to go to a lawyer. Like, this is the thing, this is going to be a commodity. Like, and there's lots of websites out there, like Legal Zoom is one. I can't think of all the names off the top of my head. I actually have them all written down here. But they all provide those kind of services. And when you think, okay, well, I'm a lawyer and I'm supposed to draft stuff, well, the machine can do it. So that's why I'm asking you to think, because you need different types of skills if computers can do this stuff. Predictive artificial intelligence. And this is being used in, okay, if I go to court, based on the precedents that have gone before me, what are the odds that I'm going to succeed in court? Smart legal contracts. Actually, so I'm a finance lawyer, and I was reading today, so ISDA, which is the International Society Derivatives Association, so for derivative contracts, for master agreement derivative contracts, they've been trying to move to smart contracts, which are self-executing virtual contracts, for years. They just haven't pulled the trigger yet. But now, because of COVID and because people aren't in their offices talking on the phones anymore, doing over-the-counter swaps, they are thinking about doing the smart contract thing straight away. So that just goes to show you, like, in finance, it's starting to be used. It's ubiquitous with blockchain technology. So like, I've seen it in the finance industry, but no doubt it'll start to come into other industries. Knowledge management and research systems. If you've ever like paralegaled or interned in a law firm, you will have seen these. And then there's another kind of section of law tech which I find very interesting, and that's the area around due diligence and kind of natural language processing. So basically what you do is you teach the software how to pick up certain terminology. So we'll say you have 10,000 documents for review. Normally this would be split between a number of teams in a law firm. They would, like, it's ridiculous, they would go and print everything out and like use their eyes, which I know your eyes are great, but you're going to be wrong 20% of the time. So you have a 1 in 5 chance of being wrong, whereas the machine has 100% chance of being right, and it's much just easier to review the machine's results. But anyway, they've done the tests, and the lawyers failed against the robots when it came to just simple reviewing contracts and finding the clause, which is not something you need inherent legal skill to do. You can teach anybody to do that. So yeah, for due diligence, their days are definitely numbered in M&A transactions. So yeah, like, obviously there are lots of downsides economically for the legal industry, in terms of man/woman power and billable hours, and it's good for clients that costs are reduced. However, I think personally, the rise of law tech can be very beneficial for lawyers. So for example, if you're highly trained, which we all are, you spend one third of your time in the workplace doing administrative tasks that you weren't trained for and don't come in within the remit of law. Like, for example, filing stuff and sending letters, like normally stuff that's done by secretaries, but a lot of cutbacks have come, so a lot of lawyers have to do this themselves. Like, you could argue that that's not a lawyer's job, but sometimes you just have to do it and suck it up, and that's fine. Arguably, if all the administrative tasks are being done in a like robotic fashion or being automated, that gives time to the lawyers to like think about a strategy, which is not something really a robot can do. Strategy for the client, to be more facilitating for the client and have more time to come up with innovative solutions as to the way forward, which is much more helpful than you sitting there writing letters and kind of like corresponding back and forth and negotiating a contract, which could be self-executed very, very quickly online. So yeah, there's upsides and downsides as well. And the other thing as well is the area of in-house. The in-house lawyer is growing massively, as you can imagine, as more companies are trying to reduce their cost, their legal bill. Like JP Morgan did this by millions. Like, I think they had something like 80 million of a legal bill, and they just brought it in-house. They streamlined it, automated it, used their technologies, and saved themselves a fortune. The other thing as well is if the lawyer is in-house, they know the business much, much better, and they don't need to have to be explained every single time. So what's happening a lot is you're getting people who are quite specialized going in-house, and that alleviates the need to go to external counsel all the time, which saves a heap of money. And like, you're seeing this in all areas. And the other thing as well is, which is something that has come out of the COVID, is use of electronic signing, which is completely admissible as evidence in court. It holds the same weight as a wet ink signature, and the DocuSign kind of Adobe companies are doing very, very well out of this, because everybody's at home now and ain't nobody going to pay money to like courier your wet ink signature across town and back and all of this. So you know, that is one example of how the innovation is saving businesses, and it's not necessarily anything to do with lawyers.
Yeah, like the moral of the story is it's nothing to get hung up about. You need to be aware of it as a young lawyer. You need to know where you're going. You need to know what's on the horizon. Otherwise, it's just it's unwise to be unaware. I'm telling you now that law tech is a thing. Make sure you bring it up in your job interview. Just be like, you know, you've done the reading, you've listened to me, or you've done your own stuff, and that you're aware of it, and you know the benefits it can have. Law firms will want to see that you want to make money for them. So, you know, you need to impress on them that you understand that administrative tasks do make money, but ultimately it's all about your reputation. Reputation is how you drum up business. It's not necessarily how expensive your service is. So I think awareness of this will definitely feed into the commercial awareness part of your traineeship interview. And yeah, if you have any questions, please contact me. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.